The government, meanwhile, had been drafting legislation aimed at controlling rave culture. Amendments to the Criminal Justice Bill in 1994 defined a rave as anything more than 100 people listening to amplified music characterized by the emission of successive, repetitive beats. Not since Oliver Cromwell's Sunday observance laws had Parliament tried to stop people dancing.
For the first time, I think people felt like, yeah, this is our land, this is our country, and we want to party, and why not? And who's to say that we shouldn't do that? And if they are, why are they saying that? And who's this thing called the state saying, you're not allowed to have fun, and you can't go into a field and dance all night if you want to? So basically, yeah, prerequisite of human experience and prerequisite of human right, I would have thought.
Ravers and crusties forged an alliance to fight for their right to party.
I've got to stand and fight in this creation. Vanity, I know, can't guide I alone. I'm searching to find a love that lasts all time.
Despite protests, the Criminal Justice Bill became law in November 1994. Of course, it did nothing to stop house music's evolution.
Dance music was always viewed as a faceless entity, wasn't it? Left field didn't really want to be seen. You know, they didn't want the fame. But they knew that they had to bring it to a live stage and a live standard. It was like, you know, we just want to rock you. And that was the difference. And they pulled it off live. And a lot of, you know, a lot of bands still don't do that now. You know, they do a lot to playback and play bits live. Left Field played live. They had a drummer. They had, you know, it was brilliant. It's brilliant.
Researching.
Left Field drew on house, techno and dub to create a distinctly British sound.
Neil was a massive reggae fan, more than me. He's had a lot of history with reggae. It wasn't a dance record, it was just more a bit of an experiment really, with a few beats and like, it is an unusual tempo again, it's like 110 BPM. It wasn't really prime time kind of dance music, you know. But we knew it was our own sound, so we just went ahead and we released it on our own label, Hard Hands.
Musically, nothing else was sounding like Left Field. You know, a lot of it was kind of sounding a bit aboriginal, and there was all mad sounds like Ouija this and wobbly that, and you know, just so different, so original, so groundbreaking. Got what they deserved, basically. Can't say enough good about them. They are my idols.
And in 1993 they pulled off one of house's most audacious acts of assimilation.
I think it's probably one of the best records we ever made, definitely, you know. It was something. And we knew it was different, because it had all these influences of techno, world music, dub, with John Lydon on.
The granddaddy of punk, John Lydon, stamped his unique endorsement on UK house.
We wanted to do something different, and we'd always talked about doing a track with John, and we had a kind of a demo of a track which we sent over to John, and he just sort of rang us back and said, where's the fucking chorus, sort of thing. And like, I remember saying to people, I've just done a track with John Lydon, people going, really, like that sort of thing, you know. So I suppose people couldn't imagine what it would be like. And then a few people came down the studio, I played it to them, and they were just blown away, you know. And I knew then that we had something good, and we got a great performance out of John. It was the record that crossed us over into mainstream pop music, I suppose, for want of better words, you know. It was a record suddenly that if you weren't into dance music, but you liked punk or you liked rock music, you could suddenly get into this, but it had a groove.
Left Field proved that by the mid-90s, the UK had well and truly made house music its own.
I mean, where Paul Daly gets that bass from, I do not know.